All right. Welcome back.
We're back.
It's been a while, but we had this equipment coming in. We ordered it from sweatshop in China, and so custom order. It took the kids a while. It took them a couple months. Yeah. But like knowing that our quality was going to be better, we didn't want to let you guys down, you know. And also, another thing, the male has to stop, ladies, really. How many women have threatened self-harm?
I think several.
If we didn't post again. I think I saw in the news that one of them has passed away. So it's very tragic. But tragic. If you'd have just had patience.
I don't know if they passed away because of the fact that we ordered these ones.
I think it was kind of she'd lost hope in life or something because we were like the only thing. That's what her note said, at least. We were the only thing keeping her around. Yeah. She sent it to us in the mail. Yeah. She had a couple. I haven't been showing it to you because I know you're sensitive. You're more sensitive than I am to human plight. You know,
I care about
she had a couple kids and everything.
Oh, it's crazy. That's horrible.
All jokes, obviously.
All jokes. Nobody has died. We have not caused the death of any woman, man, or child for the lack of our content.
We are dying to ourselves right now, though.
Exactly.
Because we're in Lent. I don't know how many of our followers are Catholic. Probably most of them, yeah.
Probably.
It's our friends. Thing. Yeah.
Exactly.
But we don't have anything to talk about today. We just hopped in front of the camera. So
because of this desperate situation that we've put the world in.
Yeah.
Namely, you know, fucking not having our...
our content.
Content out there. So, you know.
We're going to let the intro roll. I know you guys have missed it. We kept that the same. There's something inside you. It's hard to explain. They're talking about you, boy. But you're still the same. So our main topic today is one that's been on America's mind and America's heart. In America's genitals, see my genitals at least, is Travis Kelce and the first lady of the NFL, Taylor Swift, taking the world by storm, really.
Yeah.
I didn't even watch the game. I just walked down after the Chiefs won because I wanted to know if he was going to propose or they were going to sacrifice to Moloch or something like that. I don't know. I don't know.
It was
I thought something.
It was an important moment for...
it's fine, we'll fix it. Important moment for the culture, really.
It wasn't for the culture with a capital K. Yeah. I actually don't know if the culture really gave a shit.
Yeah. Frankly. Yeah. More people were mad about it than cared about it, I think.
I think so.
The NFL, but my opinion, my personal opinion, is that the NFL, if this wasn't fake or if this isn't fake, you're gonna start seeing it happen a lot more often.
Just like celebrities
getting
with NFL players for clout.
Because they just now realize, like, yo, like, how much content,
we
how much
can
money.
Make money off this.
Yes, bro.
Well, it's like, it is every, like, teenage white girl's, like, dream.
No, that is the American.
It's the American dream.
She's become the girl in the fucking music
video. In her songs.
Video.
She's in become
her. The other music video for You Belong With Me, the villain. You never watched that?
I actually never
Taylor
watched
Swift was a staple of my childhood.
Bad Blood was actually the only Taylor Swift music video
I like her music, watched. I guess. I'm not a Swiftie, but I like her music. But in the it's about You Belong With Me, it's about her being nerdy and artistic, and you know, she wears high heels, I wear t-shirts. She's cheer captain and I'm on the bleachers. Well, who's the cheer captain now, Mrs. Swift?
It's not you, because you make too much money to cheer.
But
you're too good for it?
She is cheering. She's drinking. That's what I saw her doing. The only thing I saw her do at the Super Bowl is chug a beer.
What do you think? Oh, it was a beer. You think she's a beer woman? She doesn't have the body of a beer woman.
She seems like a fucking martini woman.
She seems like a purge after two tequila soda limes, which is what I do, by the way.
And you guys have the same body type, so it makes
obviously
sense. Yeah.
Taylor Swift and I have the... Yeah, exactly.
But no, my prediction is corporate, interest in... athlete celebrity relations now, right? Because it used to be like in the NBA, like the celebrities would be at the game,
right? And the whole thing was like, oh, I got courtside tickets.
Yeah, but there was like a distinct separation in classes, right?
Right.
Like these are our kind of
the
gladiators, and these are our, you know, patrician type people, right?
But now it's like you get this intermingling of the classes that I think is probably symptomatic of the decline of the American empire.
Could be.
Would you say? Let's look at history and see. Like, when do
now,
these two classes intermingle?
It's interesting, though. Yeah, it's like the celebrities in NFL games don't sit field side.
They sit in the boxes.
They sit in the box, which is much more of a patrician move.
Yeah.
I think that's pretty interesting. I don't know.
They need someone. Who is the guy I read about him that to tear the boxes down so the poor plebs
could
watch?
Sit somewhere. Yeah, yeah. Exactly. Yeah,
and,
dude.
And then kill him. They'll kill him
for sure. Yeah. I don't know which era of Roman history that was. Would that have been like?
And it was the guy that was like signaling the decline. It was one of the brothers.
The Gracchi.
Yeah, it was one of the Gracchi. It was the second Gracchi.
The Gracchi.
Yeah, yeah. I've been reading a lot about Roman history. That's got me thinking about like football players as gladiators.
For sure.
Really, I mean, what else? Like, we've at least left behind that barbaric convention of death, right? But I think that's because we don't like any finality.
But have we, though?
We don't like any sense of finality.
For sure.
Have we? What do you mean?
Well, it's just like, you're just delaying their death. Like, the most popular sports.
Brain sport. Death, exactly. Really? Brain death.
Like, the most popularly... watch sports in America are like fighting and football.
Yeah.
The two most traumatic, like brain injury, traumatic to the head sports.
Mm.
So, yeah, they're both gladiatorial.
Yeah. I guess I mean like the spectacle of like blood, etc.
For sure.
And kind of like the high stakes. Well, yeah. I mean, that's even, seizure, we're even getting closer to Roman that way.
Right.
You know, DeMar. Died a gladiator's death, almost.
Almost. For 3 seconds, he died a gladiator's death.
Did he win comeback player of the year?
He didn't. Joe Flacco did.
Come on. The dude is on his deathbed.
I know.
I love Joe Flacco, but I mean.
Okay, but still being like a starting safety, you know, like after dying.
Medically dying.
Right. Like.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, but somebody who came out of retirement after not being relevant and then. You know, we get it.
Flacco won a Super Bowl. He got
Browns,
all the
getting
all
the Browns to a playoff game is a death-defying feat. Apparently, they're putting it at the same level.
Yeah.
No, they just don't want to see a black man have the comeback player of the year.
That's my. We live in Houston. I won't tell you which part of Houston. This is the gay part, but
figure it out.
But we could have swept, or at least almost swept. The damn NFL awards we had Stroud and then what's the guy's name,
Anderson.
Yeah, Anderson. And then D'Amico Ryans, so you telling me he's not coach of the year?
No.
But they think the NFL is so racist.
It is.
They think
free black,
they think coaching position, they think administrator, orchestrator, real kind of theoretical calculation, and they go, it's got to be a white guy,
right?
They don't want to see
they think quarterback.
Yeah, it was a miracle that Stroud got it, and that's because he's half white. But really, they don't want to see a black man succeed, and they don't want to see the city of Houston succeed, and they've never wanted to. Ultimately.
Because I think like the city of Houston really is like an underdog in a lot of respects when it comes to cities. Yeah. Like,
okay, how so?
Well, you said okay. Let's talk. You got New York. Obviously, has to be like it's East Coast. So East Coast shit is like automatically like this is where America was
it's the founded. Pearl of the West. The jewel
exactly.
of the West.
It's the jewel of the West. It's a fucking island. It's the center of like financial activity in America. You have like Chicago, which is like the breadbasket market of like America, which means the world, you know. Next to Ukraine. putting Chicago and Ukraine on the same levels.
Chicago has a city and the entire nation.
Exactly.
Terrible,
You know, the same amount of food.
same amount of casualties. Right.
Chi-kraine. Jesus Christ. Chi-kraine. I'm coining it now. The next Kanye-esque album is going to be like, I'm doing a Chi-kraine reference. talking about how yuppies are invading.
Yeah.
Saying, this used to be our place.
You never heard of the World's Fair in Ukraine?
yeah, but I think just Houston's an underdog.
Yeah, and then you have Los Angeles, which is, you know.
Right, but like, yeah, I guess LA is like
That's no, it's New York, LA. I think we are surpassing Chicago, really.
We are. I think we're already third.
I think we're the largest population. Port in the world, or one of them. One of the largest.
Oh,
ports
for sure.
In the world.
I mean, like, yeah. In terms of trade and shit like that.
And then yeah. Texas has enough oil to be like a leading world supplier.
Yeah.
That's
true.
So if we wanted
to. Although the like Dakotas and like that whole part of the America is where we get
most of it.
Most of it, because of the whole like shale discoveries and stuff like that. It was super big back in like 2010. I'm an oil magnate now.
Yes, that's actually what Sal's been doing. Exactly. Yeah. He's been a moving player on the world stage,
basically.
Really.
Yeah.
Are you dealing with Raytheon now?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Always. The Raytheon contracts are coming. The Lockheed Martins.
Yeah.
The Shells, the BPs.
He stopped picking sides. Let's just put it that
exactly.
way.
Let's just say
business is business.
All of my political rants at any other point in this podcast.
Mean nothing.
Yeah, I sold out. So what are you gonna do? I got the bag. Yeah. I am the American dream.
He's done a number on his soul.
For sure.
But you know that's.
I mean, I lash myself at night, so I think that's.
There you go.
It equals out.
Not just for Lent either. Just like
no, just in general.
Yeah, like, I think it's a prudent thing. Really,
the self hatred. I wear like a spike garter.
Yeah,
sometimes.
We're meant to like. For physical symbols of right. like internal realities, right? So like the
exactly.
lashing,
yeah,
it's very effective.
I have red stripes on my soul, so I should have them on my body.
Yeah, it's meet and right and just, etc. That's actually how I was trying to quit nicotine for a while, and I used to lash myself every time I would have the urge, and it just got to a point where it physically just wasn't the best thing. Yeah.
Because the urges come a lot.
Well, when I was younger, I had like a bad habit of swearing, right? Mm-hmm. And it would get me in trouble at school. But like, I would never get in trouble with my parents because they're the ones that taught me to do that, right?
Right.
And
right.
But then like people would just say, you know, like, why don't you like wear a rubber band around your wrist, and every time you cuss, like, snap it.
Because I want to have a hand.
Yeah, but I'm such a masochist.
Right.
That I would like just
even when you weren't swearing,
I would just curse and then I would do it, you know? And I would get. I was in third grade getting aroused in the classroom because I was, you know, mutilating myself with a rubber band. And then
that, aroused?
Aroused, yeah, that's what I said.
Okay.
Yeah. Roused, sure. Aroused, both of those, actually.
I'm glad.
This was very formative to my character.
For sure.
As you can see. But, I mean, quitting habits is hard. We're finding that out in Lent. I probably will never try to quit swearing because I don't think it's wrong, personally. I don't have a problem with it. There's certain words you can't say.
Yeah.
Certain words people own, right, as a people. But
well, I don't know.
Are you going to challenge that notion on the podcast?
I fucking swear a fucking lot.
Yeah.
I just think that, like, I'm about doing things that are deviant.
Yes.
But keeping them deviant.
Understand them always as deviant.
Exactly.
Don't try to pretend that they're normal.
Right. Don't normalize the deviancy.
If you're going to be a freak, bro, just be a freak.
Right.
But don't try to get it put on like mainstream television. Because then all of a sudden
you're losing. Or in children's reading hours.
Right. Don't try to get it at the public library.
Not the public library.
You know what I mean?
We only already have homeless people masturbating in the public libraries. Yeah. We don't need cross-dressers to
Yeah. And like
the children are being scandalized. Don't worry. It's okay.
Well, and isn't the whole draw the thing is that like only vanilla stuff gets put on the mainstream culture, right? Like, why would you want to be vanilla, you know?
Well, that's the thing is it's like it becomes ultimately just like I wanted to like bat this idea around of like the way in which like media especially contributes to normalization. I mean, which is ultimately all according to like economic factors and everything like that. I don't know if we want to go there.
Well, let's talk about it. Let's talk about it. Now we've got some substance.
Exactly. There's a little substance.
Yeah.
We found our way in.
Yeah. It took a while. Thank y'all for bearing with us.
Yeah.
So, okay. The way that media contributes to normalization. Do you think that there is ever a vested economic interest or a vested cultural interest in normalizing certain things? Do you think that there's a shadow cabal up there somewhere that does this? Or is it a natural kind of flow of culture, like symptomatic of where a people is at?
Well, I think it's like...
Because like you don't need coherent like who quoted this? I don't like the guy that quoted it. Sure. Oh, George Carlin. He's funny, but he's stupid. But you don't need where interests align, there you have conspiracy, right? Like, yeah. You don't necessarily need to have like shadow meetings about it.
Yeah.
It's just like conspiracy kind of sometimes arises out of the vested interests of a particular group. Like, they will just choose for themselves, right? So do you think it's something like that as far as normalization goes, or is it something more insidious, more calculated about
it? I think it's like normalization. It's interesting because it's like, I think it's predominantly for like economic interests, because you can't sell something and like, you can't sell something and profit off of it without first normalizing it, because then you can scale it out, right? Mm-hmm. Like, if it's on the margins, if it's deviant, then you can't profit off of it in any way. But in terms of like conspiracy, this is like evil. Evil doesn't have like a face, you know? And although that's like how we tend to like look at how evil operates, like, we want to operate by picking out a figure, like a scapegoat. This is why like scapegoating was like such a popular practice, because of the fact that like you put all the sins on this one physical thing or person and then destroy it, and so the problem's gone. But it's like, evil is much more complex because of the fact that it remains in some way like shadowy and formless, but not in a conspiratorial way, in the sense that there's a shadow cabal or something like that, but in the sense that like it exists within a system and oftentimes like is the result of like slight deviations that become normalized, that then basically create this whole like amalgamation of this anti-system that then becomes operational, and is operational in the sense that it's like mechanical and like does the thing and the wheels keep churning, but at the same time completely leads you away from the end that the original operation was like intended for, or yeah. Something like that.
Like, and so like, what do you make of like the notion then that it seems like evil will only ever exist according to like, well, then this is just philosophy, like, yeah. Only ever exist according to the nature of that which it has corrupted.
Yeah.
Right. So the evil in a specific system is going to be in some way conditioned, maybe entirely conditioned by the like the good that that system was aiming towards.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm thinking now of like, okay, corruption in the church, right? Or corruption of a figure of authority. The damage that that does, right? Or the form that that kind of evil takes is conditioned by the good that an authority figure was supposed to play.
Yeah.
Right? Because that's what it like corrupts, right? So you have something like, I don't know, the mistrust or the like inability to, you're violated by an authority figure. You now mm-hmm. like, you're doing this valiant thing to like assert yourself and break free of like chains that you perceive on you, because the evil occurred to you according to the good that was supposed to be there.
Yeah.
Right. And so you bring that to like, so that's on like a 1-to-1, but like you bring that to like the scale of something like an economics, institution, right?
Or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah. An institution, or like even just like the economic system. Yeah. Right. Like, okay, so what's the good? What good is our economic system aimed towards?
Yeah.
First of all.
Right.
And then,
right.
What does that say about the way that it would decay? And then you'll find your shadow cabal, right? Yeah. Or you'll find, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, it's like, yeah, it's, yeah, because I, but then it's also like strange, because then you have ends that are built up that are just shitty ends, right? Like, it's like
if the system wasn't like good to begin with.
Exactly. Like, because I'm thinking of like conspiracy in the sense of like institutions that are obviously like intended for the good, right? Like the church, or the institutional aspect of the church, like government, like education, things like this, which like actually have explicit intentions of like our goal is such and such, right? But it's like you talk about something like an economic system that's put up in such a way, it's like the like Western world is pretty clear about the fact that like the actual end is profit, and that like somehow the good will be achieved somewhere in that mix, you know, like as long as we focus on this, then like we can essentially make this mechanical system that will like lift all boats.
So then right? even that okay, as like inherently misled, right?
Yeah.
Then following the logic would be a corruption of some kind of higher aim, right? So like even our entire economic system aimed strictly at profit,
right?
What did that corrupt according to, right? Is it human flourishing? Is it the desire for peace, right? or something like that?
Well, I mean, like, okay, originally economics in general was just like the science or like the art of essentially keeping a household, right? Like, or like keeping something in the sense that like it was ancillary to the end of, you could think a household at one level, which is like the actual like oikos, right? Like the literal etymology of it. But then eventually it was, you know, of course applied to levels up to the city. And then that was like, how do you just keep this as an ancillary kind of almost like secondary system within, let's say, politics or something like that. Like economics serves politics and the end of politics. But then, you know, you kind of begin to see that it, like, with the disparation of political life in general in, like, throughout history, you just see the economics essentially become its own monster and its own kind of science, in the sense that, like, now it can be plucked from this specific management of particular of a particular city or something like that to a general kind of human goal of like profit, right? And everybody has different reasons for this profit, but that's the beautiful thing about it, is that like it's vague enough where, and speaking specifically about like Western capitalist economics, that like there we can create this invisible hand, which is kind of what we're talking about in a lot of sense. This is like this idea that
sounds like our notion of evil.
Right, exactly. Yeah, I mean, it's true. It's like basically that like everything will work out if everybody just recognizes that, like, because the whole model of capitalism is built on the fact that we're predicting that human nature is such and such a way, and that not that people should necessarily operate based off of profit
but
alone,
but they will,
and so we're gonna operate off of profit alone because that's how we keep it practical. And so we operate with each other on the basis of self-interest, on the basis of like this is the operation of trade and everything like this, not on like objective meeting of human needs or anything like that, but or only insofar as if we do that, we will also be in some way benefited, right? Like,
so if the failure there is, right, this kind of isolation of the economic principle, right, and its application, you know, like across multiple, like across wherever, because like you've said, well, it's strictly going to be for profit. It's no longer like connected to like an actual tangible like good or goal. Could somebody say that, okay, given, right, that that's happened or something, still in a society where tangible, real good and goals are like clear, firmly established, that something can be made even of economics stripped from like an explicit connection to something, right? So it's like, if a good nation profits, isn't it good, right? Like, or is it necessary for the good, for any like kind of economic system to be good, for it to be explicitly connected to something beyond itself?
Yeah.
Or can it be like, we could say that, like, okay, we do this thing with profit.
Yeah.
But that's because we're, like, extremely flawed in what we value, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. But say
could
that...
Could this be turned for good?
Yeah. Or is it like, no, actually, this kind of profit is the thing driving most of our shift in value.
Yeah.
Like, it's going to corrupt any kind of good aim that we put it towards strictly because it's not bounded or not connected to it. Like,
yeah.
Is that connection to something further, like an essential principle of economics? Is it always going to go astray when it's removed or kind of isolated, right? I guess.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's like, because it's like, yeah, like, because we're talking about, right, like, profit, which equals, in today's world of, like, value being placed at the level of money and stuff like that, money is essentially potential or power, right? And so you could say it's the same argument as, like, money is power, basically. And so you essentially just take power and you say, well, power can be used for good or evil. It's moderate. It's neutral, right? But it's like, but the goal, the end, if the end is defined by the growth of potential, right? Then you're positing something about human nature, that that is what human beings need, right? Like, for some kind of fulfillment, right? Whether that's final or in the meantime. Which I think is like, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of like nuance in terms of like, whether we're talking about a strictly capitalist system or something different, but like, generally speaking, we're talking about Adam Smith, Wealth of Nations type capitalism, then like, I think the main problem is the fact that you are saying something about human nature. And when you're saying something about human nature and the system only works if that human nature is presupposed, then it actually creates that human nature, right? Like, people begin to act in the way that you posited they would act because the system in some sense imposes itself on the individual rather than like arising in a kind of natural way or something like that. The system will actually become what is presupposed about the individual. So like, if you presuppose that humans are selfish and will only act in terms of self-interest, you begin to use a predictive analysis of human nature to gain profit, for example. Then it's like, you're presupposing that, and then the only way it seems to get profit is to act in the similar way, you know?
Well, to make that tangible, it's like what you were saying the other day about, like, living for the weekend, right?
Right, exactly.
Like, if your system, like, presupposes that nothing else is necessary for human, like, for a human being than
right.
Material well-being, right? Then you give them 2 days and let them sleep it
bread
off
and circuses,
bring
yeah.
them back, right? Like, yeah. Yeah, he doesn't even sleep it off. But
well, it's like
because but yeah. that's like the kind of person you create then.
Yeah.
Like you build a system for it, you put him in there, he's not going to eat if he doesn't work, and then you build men like that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's like, okay, yeah, let's posit the system. You have a couple options, right? Like, you can invest. Okay, you have all this excess wealth, right? You can invest the money. Right? You can, but it's like, that seems a little bit weird in terms of like kind of looking at it from a sense of finality, because it's like, I get all this money to put it into a bank or an investment to essentially make more money. But it's like, working also gets me more money. But like, also, like, okay, that doesn't really make sense, because money as power doesn't make sense to be used to gain more power, because that's just potential trying to get more potential that's never actually actualized, right? And then, okay, so I have power. What am I going to do with that power? I can use it for pleasure, right? Which is the living for the weekend thing. I can use it to build a church or something like that, right? Like, you can use it for good ends. But then it's like, okay, then you have the question of like, people can use it for good ends. Does that justify the means of that, like, wealth creation? And then you get into the whole question of like, okay, even if you did have I just think in general, like, for profit, building a system off of that just doesn't work for the goals of human living, because there's an objective goal of human living. Okay, we exist in it, so what do we do with it? Well, then you have the question of, like, what are the means of gaining that wealth? And then that's a whole other, like, problem, because of the fact that, like, there's a principle of ownership that has to kind of come into play, in the sense that, most of the way that we make money is off of like corporate servitude, you know. I want to say corporate slavery, but you know, would have had.
It's a buzzword.
It's a buzzword, you know.
YouTube won't let
us. I just don't think I don't want to spend the next 5 minutes talking about the distinction between service and like slavery and the whole Roman man. Yeah.
I didn't know there was a distinction.
Well, it's, you know. Do you want me to talk?
Go ahead.
Sure.
Was this something invented by people who had a vested interest in keeping slaves, or does it go like further?
Okay, so
like, yeah, there's a difference.
Well, yeah, because it's like the sense in which slavery was used for like thousands of years.
Like when Aristotle says some people are natural slaves.
Yeah, right. It's what he means by that is that like when he says some people are natural slaves, right? He's not thinking chattel slavery where you're like actually owned by the person.
Because that was actually like a new.
Yeah.
Like, well, I mean, I'm sure that it existed throughout history, though.
Yeah, but there's a principle that was like anytime that you actually owned somebody, right, which was in like the Roman Empire and was eventually abolished by Christendom, was the idea of ownership of somebody was only, you only had a right to own somebody if they were spoils of war or something like that, right? I'm not saying it's good or anything like that, but it's not like racially based or anything like that. And you don't just randomly, I mean, it's racially based if you, you know, conquer Carthage or something like that, or Greece, then you got a bunch of Greek slaves, which is popular. But at the same time, it's like there was always an opportunity for the gaining of freedom and stuff like that, legitimately. But the general sense of slave was like somebody who sold their labor. And a free man was defined as somebody who essentially owned the means of their production. Because of the whole fact that like there's this, what Aristotle saw was this incredible like unification of like me actually deciding what the ends of my work are, you know, like, and only free men are able to do that basically. And actually it's unclear whether it's the free man that owns property or if it's the property owning man that's free, because of the fact that it's like, because I always say that because it's like the Americans think that like you're a property owning man, that means you're free. And that's like a niche distinction, but it's like the meaning of slavery is just that like you don't own the means of your production. So it's like I work at a corporate 9-to-5, all of the instruments, well, this is a bad example, but like let's say you work on an oil field or something like that. It's like all of the instruments that you're using, you don't own them. The reason why you're like mining for oil or something like that, or where the oil goes, you don't decide, you don't care. You're literally just their labor. Your labor is seen as a kind of tool or as capital to the people who actually own it and decide what is this being used for, right? And so there's a sense in which that's okay, but it's also, it's interesting because Aquinas would say that's also a product of sin, right? Like not being able to own that. That's an intermediary state between, like, we should always be working for full ownership of the means of our production, basically. Like what we live off of, what we profit off of should correlate with, you know, what we actually do, where we work, you know?
And so then I have a question about, okay, you talk about the ultimate aim being ownership, right? Of the means of like your work.
Yeah.
So then what that seems to imply, right? Because I know that there's the teaching that, you know, ownership is connected with use.
Yeah.
But what that seems to imply is at least some kind of system that recognizes or validates or like betokens ownership.
Yeah.
Right? So then you move into something like, you know, like state records or something like you need to build systems around who owns what, right?
Yeah.
Which then moves into, but if it's connected like ultimately with use, I think like the moment that you start building that system around ownership, that leads into, you know, incentives to say, well, this people that owns this are now subject to these taxes or to these, you know, regulations or something like that. Like, it seems like even in the very principle of ownership, what's implied is the building of something higher or more broad to regulate the ownership itself. So if ownership is the ultimate end of kind of our work,
yeah.
What type of thing then is regulation, right? Or is it proper that that occurs? Like, so, or how can ownership be an ultimate end, right? When then you're going to need people or something to facilitate recognition of ownership on a practical level. And so then it would seem like you could say that the flourishing of that becomes the end of work. Like, we own, and then we have, but we're subject to this higher kind of thing. And so wouldn't you say that the health or the or participating or contributing to that becomes higher than like your own sort of ownership? Or is there a way to navigate between that?
Well, it's like I think ownership is a principle of like the natural law, right? But private ownership isn't necessarily.
Okay, what do you mean?
Like it makes a lot more sense, private property from a like prudential perspective, right? But whether we can say that that's the right of every human being in the sense of like nature to own something privately, specifically privately, I don't think it's the case that that's actually a principle of the natural law. But I do think that it's a very good prudential aspect of like the human law, right? So, okay, we should own things, and it's right to own things because of our dominion over the earth and everything like that, and to own, like, ownership is a prior reality before use. And so if we're going to use the land and ensoul it in a way, that's the way that like Hegel would talk about ownership, would be like you're actually uniting this instrument into your body or to your intention, and then actually ensouling that object, kind of like spreading yourself not out into a world of like potential the way that Locke would have it, but like ensouling the world in a sense of like adding to the ends and almost like divinizing it, you know, like taking that end of that particular thing and then bringing it higher, elevating it in a way. Like the ultimately our work is for the glory of God, right? So how does a tree glorify God? Well, it already does glorify God in a way, but can it be built into a boat to travel the seas, to see the wonders of the world, to like witness the glory of God, etc.? Like, it's like humans are called to instrumentalize in some sense certain things, but never to undermine the glorification of that thing, right? So always to work with. And so like, okay, how do we do that? Well, it makes most sense, especially in a world of sin, to be like certain people own certain things because of the fact that it's like, okay, we have this land. Who's going to be the administrator of this land or the owner of this land? All these people are going to do it. Well, sometimes it might actually be a good thing. This is the idea of like the commons, right? Like common, like farm land or something like that, where people actually come together and work together to essentially use the same land to basically plant their harvest and everything like that. And however that's delegated out by the relevant authority. This is a popular, or like the specific places where you live, for example, you know, like the administration of this place where you live is probably better because so that somebody doesn't just claim that they also have a right to kind of, you know, be there. But that's always a function of kind of
sin,
relative prudence.
Well, right? Like, or it's a result of sin.
Yeah, because
the necessity to
we
do
wouldn't
it.
Fight if there weren't
yeah,
sin.
Yeah.
You know, like we would all have the wisdom and the prudence and also the temperance to be able to essentially have dominion and share in a way that's like,
yeah,
you know, not in a kind of like idealistic sense, but in a kind of truly like everybody still does stuff relevant to it. But this whole spatting about like relevance of, well, this one's mine, and this is mine, and this is mine, you know, like...
Where does genuine common ownership still exist today, right? Because you have, I'm thinking most lands that aren't privately held are held by the city, Does that constitute, right, a common ownership? I wouldn't think so. I don't feel that I own the things that the city owns.
Yeah.
I don't have any. I mean, I participate insofar as I use them or I'm able to make use of them. But something is amiss there, right? Like, is there any instance of genuine common ownership, or have we been converted entirely to the notion of private ownership?
I think in the American system, yeah. Well, it's just the notion of ownership in general has changed so much that it's kind of hard to think, because like you were saying, it's like even something like, let's say, state ownership or something like that. Well, now it's like the political authority is considered as a political person, right? Or as like a legal person. And so because they're a legal person, they're the ones who essentially have private ownership over this thing, right? And so it's not in, like, obviously they have certain obligations and certain, like, to their constituents, but like it's a little like the whole idea of property as something that is essentially just the tool of one's subjective will really changes the landscape in terms of what is like what do we mean when we talk about the right to own something? What do we mean when we say like the authority over something, right? Like, because whether somebody has the title of deed or the deed of ownership was different than somebody who might have authority over that same land. For example, it's like in the Middle Ages, like, yes, it was understood that a peasant would own the land that they worked on sometimes, or the place that they lived or something like that, but the king had authority over that land still. You know, like, it was never, in some sense,
there wasn't a tension between the two.
Exactly. Nations. Right. Because that's the thing, is it's like in, let's say, like a medieval order, all of that thing was so integrated into this like cosmic sacramental vision that you were like, why do we need to delineate all of the, like, obviously we need to delineate between these things so that when it does come to a court of law or something like that, or we do have a dispute, that there are rights and, of course, like things like this. But this is how the whole common law tradition started, was that like judges' prudence in particular matters set the foundations for how other people would arbitrate such decisions, you know, basically using justice as the means. This is why what a lot of people don't like about the whole idea of the universal destination of goods is the fact that, like, well, somebody's right to ownership is not necessary, or private ownership specifically, is not absolute by natural law. Otherwise, that would mean that when somebody did it, even if it was justified by the circumstances, it would still be stealing, right? But Thomas doesn't say that. He says it's not stealing because they have a right to it in particular circumstances, right?
I had a question about, like, so when you said, okay, the fact that like something like the state is acting as its own legal entity now, with regard to the land, right? Obviously a symptom of kind of our modern framework,
right?
But made me think of something like the church, right?
Yeah,
where it is good and right that the church own the land that her churches are built on,
for sure. Yeah.
And I guess, like, what, so then now, like, in this modern framework, she then becomes, again, a private entity,
yeah,
like the state.
Yeah.
Is that something that is dangerous for the church? Or, I mean, I'm sure it's caused problems, right? You had the scandal with the property for the prophet a couple years ago. Yeah. But is it something, like, in the church's, like, nature already to, like, be able to act that way? Or is that something of like our modern conception slipping in by necessity or prudence into what the way the church has to interact with the world? Or what did it look like when she owned her land, like, to own, I guess, like the Vatican, even, yeah, right, the entire city
as its own?
Is it it can't be strictly legal when it comes to the church, right? But ultimately she's forced to play by the bounds of the world that surrounds her a lot of times. And so is there something necessarily disordered about that, like something like the state or the church taking on being a legal entity, when really they're kind of the church isn't, but I guess maybe this is the distinction between the church and the state there, but like when they're kind of just an abstract like principle,
yeah,
but they're taking on the responsibility of personhood.
Yeah.
Is there something intrinsically disordered there, like particularly with the way the church relates to the church?
Yeah. I mean, I think it's like, I'm kind of just shooting from the hip here, but like, I think the idea of like legal personhood is like interesting, and useful in certain instances. I'm like hesitant when it comes to like, for example, like a state to assume that, because it just has the flavor of like Leviathan, right? Like the idea that there's this kind of state that doesn't actually have a will or a person or something like that, that is essentially the collection of whatever administration or government essentially like decides, not in terms of like legal codification, but like it just has this like this flavor of like whatever the people decide, essentially
closed system authority
becomes, right? Yeah, well, but yeah, but it's like, yeah, but it's, I don't know, I'm trying to think of like, because it's like personhood implies in well, some like, sense, well, like a will.
If the state is illegal, taking on legal personhood, who says what the state is, right? Like, because is it persons then that like have established the state or something? Like,
right?
What is the state that is operating as a person?
Yeah.
Where did it come from? What is it comprised of? Right, like, right. Those kinds of questions, at least, are what come
well,
to me.
Well, I don't know.
Because, like, with the church, yeah, you can answer those.
Well, you think of, like, how you identify yourself as, like, an American, right? And you're like, okay, I'm an American. That means I'm a part of, like, such and such, like, kind of, there's an identity, there's a kind of, maybe culture, maybe any number of things, right, that identify you as American, right? And that is a kind of cultural category or something like that. But it's like Americanness, America, then, in that sense, isn't something that acts, really, right? It's just kind of something that is and exists in that way. But then there's also the government of the United States of America, right? And that is something that it's like, that's not to say that government isn't necessary, but it's like, it makes you think, okay, it's not even particular agents or the accumulation of agents, for example, that are doing this. It's oftentimes it's like it leads to the kind of assuming of, for example, like maybe property is a bad idea because you need some kind of stable kind of entity to sustain something through multiple different shifts or changes, right? But I'm thinking here of like, I don't know, like the FBI or the CIA, right? I'm doing this for American interests, right? For state interests, right? For interests of state, etc. But then oftentimes you'll like,
what
see
is
them.
That?
Exactly. And so you're like, well, point to the person whose interest it is. Point to the one who, it, like, it's kind of, it becomes this formless thing again, right? When you kind of grant personhood to something that is institute or to an institution or something like that. It has this kind of air of like, well, really, what, like, you know, what does that even mean? And I think it's interesting, actually, that like the theory of state that eventually becomes like the modern state comes from the model of the English king, right, with Thomas Hobbes and everything like that, who is simultaneously the head of the Church of England and the head of the State of England, right? Like, it's almost like, yeah, they're modeling themselves off of the same personhood that, say, the institutional church would have. Because I do actually think that, like,
the church can actually,
the church has a will, yeah, right? Because, yeah, the church does have a will. It's like,
because, right, I was thinking,
because Christ has a will.
Yeah. What, like, what is the distinction there? Yeah. It's like, there's genuine personhood to the church.
Yeah. The interests of the church are actually given, you right. know, the so will of the church is
it
given.
Is kind of a, yeah, they're modeling after it. Right. Yeah. And if anything, it's the tension between the, like the state kind of taking on or assuming roles that are not proper to it.
Yeah. Well, it's essentially creating this like this almost divine, but it's like almost shadowy type of, it's ethereal, this personhood onto something that essentially cannot think or will, you know. And you're like, well, that's, yeah, not to say that the institutional church per se can do those things either, because I think the institutional church per se necessarily has those qualities, but to consider the institutional church per se is to consider it an abstraction, because of the fact that the institutional church is always and at all times united to the ends of the church qua church, like just the church as
the fullest, full
as sense. The body of Christ, right? Yeah. Like yeah. In heaven and on earth and everything like that, the hierarchy, the laity, all of it. It's like to consider the legal structure of the church, or the human structure of the church, the canonical structure of the church, like in its
you can't consider that outside of
the, this is why canon law always has to be its own kind of thing, right? Like, and also always fallible, right? Like, nobody claims that canon law is dogmatic or binding in the sense of conscience, right? But in the sense of duty, or in the sense of like every Catholic recognizes that canon law is positive law. Like, yes, we obey, but we are obeying it precisely insofar as it's the Pope has authority over us, even in matters of practice and even in matters of like positive law, right? Like, so
let me see where we're at.
I don't know where this fucking digressed.
it went everywhere. Let's see. What's the timing? 52. We got some time.
Yeah. It's exhausting, dude. I'm fucking.
Yeah, I know. We're not used to this.
I know.
Yeah.
Well, I'm just like, and also I like have. It's weird because I haven't thought about these things in so long that I'm just kind of like.
You need something, bro.
I need something
to occupy your.
I do.
Your brain.
I need to write. I was reading about like G.K. Chesterton, and just like his life. And I didn't know that he just wasn't educated at the level of, like...
He wasn't an Oxford guy?
Nope. No.
Really?
All of his friends went to Oxford, but he never went.
What
I thought, because I assumed he did, too.
What was his level of education?
He went to art school for 2 years and then dropped out.
What a beast, bro.
Yeah.
What a beast.
Yeah. Like, middle-class family. Should have been, but... And then, like, made a living off of writing. Like, he never worked. He never...
Well, that's why, I mean, anything, like, his, like, collected works is, like, 3 volumes.
Right. That's all he did.
Yeah.
And it also, like, I don't know, he's kind of, I was always averse to Chesterton because I didn't want to be, like, a Chesterton bro. I'm, like...
Just don't start dressing like...
No, I'm not, yeah.
We got enough like, friends
do my,
that dress
do my, like, obligatory tweed and, like,
yeah.
Smoke pipes and, yeah. Yes.
I mean, it's a cool aesthetic. It's not my aesthetic.
Bro. No, yeah. Like, I respect people who can legitimately pull it off. I was thinking about this other thing too, about aesthetics. I was like, I really hate like retrad Americans specifically.
Okay.
Like people who LARP like aristocrats. Because of the fact that I'm like when did America ever have an aristocratic like background of any kind? It's like you're not drawing on any reality whatsoever. The closest thing we got to, I would argue, closest thing that we got to aristocracy was like the mafia, you know, like in terms of like a decentralized kind of royal family type structure.
Yeah, well, you have the Kennedys and the Clintons and the Bushes.
Sure, yeah, but those are waspy little bastards.
Yeah.
Anyway, but those are, that's not the aesthetic that they're pulling from. They're pulling from like the British kind of aristocratic thing. But I was like, but I don't find it cringe when like, for example, like even French people, like there's this like huge resurgence of like super conservative, like French people, especially like everywhere in France, but Paris really. And like they all have that kind of demeanor of like longing for the aristocracy and even dress that way sometimes too. But it's like not as corny for some reason.
Yeah. So what is the proper attire of an American with an impulse that like tends that way? What do we have to draw on in American culture, our history?
Well, that's the thing is, yeah. Our aristocrats we're all a bunch of fucking plantation owners. So it's like, I mean, if you want to draw on that, I just don't know if that's the move.
Yeah,
you know?
Maybe I'll try it one day.
Right, exactly.
See,
I think the like white suits and stuff like that.
I mean, I could wear a white suit. Like, yeah, a hard. But I wouldn't.
Like, Gatsby type vibe. Because that's what I'm saying. Like, Gatsby's wardrobe in the movie with Leonardo DiCaprio. Like, that's, I think, like, American aristocracy kind of aesthetic. Like, it's even different than British aesthetic. But it's, like, that has a kind of air to it.
Just start wearing suits.
Exactly. Yeah.
Ultimately. Like, and, like, just regular, like, just, like,
suits. But nowadays, it's, like, modern cuts, please. Not, like, fucking oversized tweed. Like,
yeah. I agree, actually.
Modern cuts, Italian suits, things that are actually in style, you know? Like, I believe there's actually something wise in, like,
dressing in style.
Just dressing in style, yeah. Like, you don't have to be, have to be a hype beast, but at the same time, you don't have to be fucking...
Yeah.
Like, I think that's also, like, a way to guard against the, like, historicist kind of mindset. It's just don't LARP. Like...
Don't romanticize a certain, you know,
eras. Right, exactly.
Yeah. Or aesthetics particularly. Maybe, like, structure of the laws.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I can romanticize.
Big antebellum guy down
there. For sure. Yeah. Yeah, maybe don't romanticize the way that's
maybe don't structured. Maybe don't name a band, you know, after it. Lady A. Doesn't matter how good your music is. None of us can justify you.
Look.
You know? Who was Lady Antebellum? No, you know, Lady Antebellum was probably the, like, mother of some of my half black friends. You know what I mean? That's what was happening to ladies in Antebellum. You know?
It's the back half of the podcast. We can say whatever the fuck we want.
We sandwich in the middle all our real stuff. Yeah, exactly.
So actually, this was all cruel ploy. I ranted about economics, that half of which I forgot about, like all of my principles and theory. Yeah. And I'm now...
Yeah. Well, so, like, basically the way we structure it is we give you a test to see whether you can stick with us through the kind of... while we find our ground.
Yeah.
And then we fucking talk, whatever. And then we get to the end, and then it's like, this is, you know, who we are.
Yes, yeah, people.
You know, I just said that I romanticized the structure of Antebellum's laws. Didn't mean a word of it, I promise.
No.
I never. I think it's a terrible thing that happened.
Actually, though, it's horrifying.
I mean...
But have you ever heard of, like, the like, black colonies in, like, South America? Like, there was a bunch of, like... Some of the slaves just, like, after the war decided to, like, start their own shit in, like, random South American countries, and, like, those places were doing super well, obviously, until racism became a thing again.
Yeah.
Or, like, Wall Street. So black economics is actually, fascinating. Really, any economics of, like, an oppressed group is fascinating, because they're usually the only people who can actually do economics right.
Yeah. Well, then you mean the economics of the whole world.
Well.
If you catch my drift.
Well.
Moses.
For sure. No, yeah.
Yeah. I'm just kidding.
The irony is. Point I had with that. No, look, I mean, read Leviticus. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Usury wouldn't be as.
prevalent.
Yeah. Don't we pray in evening prayer sometimes? Like, we chant it even. You know, who takes no interest on a loan?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, I think so. Is that the Psalms? David say?
Yeah.
But there's probably a Hebrew interpretation for sure.
Well, they've definitely, the rabbis have said something about it. Right? Probably much about it.
Right? Oh, yeah. They've completely justified it away. It's not actually in the, like, there's, that's not what they meant. It's,
yeah.
Usury is a horrible thing. We'll do our next podcast on usury. Yes.
We'll just become.
It's actually fascinating, like, the economics of it all.
Become ghetto new polity.
Ghetto new polity. Yeah, exactly.
I just have yet to watch those guys.
Yeah, they're kind of.
I've heard they're good. They did something with James Donald Forrest McKay.
Yeah.
And that was interesting.
They're good deeds. Just like.
I thought you liked them.
I do. But at the same time, I just, like, I'm a city boy, so
urban
man.
Are they big homesteaders and such?
Yeah.
It's big, like, don't homestead, action. Bro. Which what we need to do is become like our
ghettos, bro.
We'll become like our friends that we were just talking about in New York City, where they literally they have such capital, the word you like to use. They have such capital over there. I mean, there's 3 million of them in New York, right? So it's a
who of who?
more than Tel Aviv, right? It's the Jew capital of the world, really. The J capital of the world.
The J.
And they have such, they have their own police force, their own system of laws, their own section of the city. Nobody fucks with them, really, unless they start digging tunnels. Then your people go in there and fucking sort them out like old times.
Look, I wanted to go into the shul, but, you know, this is America. This is Israel. I wanted to go into the shul.
Pilot wants the shul gone.
Pilot wants the shul cleared out.
Caesar's coming.
Caesar's coming. Pilot wants the shul cleared out. No, I just think, you know, it's not even it's fucking.
But we Catholics need to do that, is what I'm saying.
Right, exactly.
Like, don't learn from any.
But we did, though. That's the thing. Like,
yeah, we need to do it again. Don't go homesteading. Live in the same area of the city and just don't let anybody do anything bad there.
When the communists were going after the Basques, like the Basque region, and, you know, the crazy Opus Dei guys got together, they created a worker cooperative that essentially is still lasting to this day and still has the same model and is actually an example of, like, Catholic corporatism that can scale up. So it's actually fascinating.
We're starting small here.
We're starting small. We're just trying to get people together, have parishes, like, open up their kitchens to, like, small businesses that can do, like, bake sales or some shit like that. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's about coordinating capital to get more capital to ultimately keep that capital in our system.
For
the glory of God, ultimately. Because, like, money is good, for sure, but it's, like, the system that the money is in. Not so good.
Not ours. It's not our system.
It's not ours. So it's not going to be good.
Yeah.
That's just a simplistic way of saying it, but I agree fundamentally.
We'd like a New Testament economic system.
New Testament economics. And not the
New
half.
Testament economics.
It's like such a
buzzword.
It's such a neocon thing to say. And I'm just like, not the half-assed, like, oh, Jesus' ethical economics, where, like, we can do capitalism, but don't maybe oppress people. Maybe don't have slavery. Yeah, that's what Jesus would want.
Yeah.
Well, it's just like, look, Reagan is putting crack in black communities, and I think that... and I think that your trickle-down, trickle-up shit just doesn't work, so... and also... capitalism and communism are the same.
There were three evil powers at the end of the Second World War. We just won.
We did win.
And the history is written by
maybe
the
there were only two.
Oh, there you go.
Maybe there were only two. I'll decide. I'll make you decide
you
which
pick.
One.
You pick.
I'll make you decide.
It's not
which
a good direction
one,
either way.
Which one?
Comment which one.
Comment which one do you think I mean after my rant today? There's two bad systems after... Two of three bad systems after World War II.
I'll give you a hint. It doesn't start with a C.
No.
Anyways, I think that's our time.
If you keep me going, I'll declare war on the world. So
we could say anything at the end here. Nobody thinks so. Nobody made it this far. Yeah.
You think so?
Except people that already know how
can
we
I
think.
Say it? Can I say it?
What are you thinking?
I'm not racist, but Irish people have to go.
Yeah, I mean, obviously.
Like first thing
obviously.
I'm doing.
Yeah.
Although Irish people are the only reason that I'm not a criminal right now. I was doing some deep reflection on this and talking to our good Irish friend. I realized that maybe our differences could be settled because of the fact that my great-grandmother was Irish. And the only reason that I'm not a criminal in New Jersey
is for
two reasons.
Yeah.
I'm not full-blooded Italian because of that Irish woman.
God bless.
And Rudy Giuliani. The damn RICO charge.
His own fucking people, man.
His own fucking people. The fucking snake.
It's the RICO. Fuck Rudy Giuliani.
Quote me.
That's wrong, bro. I don't care how effective it was, bro. It's your own people, man.
It's unconstitutional, frankly.
Yeah.
And I don't even give a shit about the Constitution, but it's unconstitutional.
Yeah. It's terrible.
I think we should get it changed.
Yeah. It's like if Obama banned Swishers. You know what I mean?
Grape Swishers.
It's really just like,
it's like if the Baba banned Tupac and Grape Swishers. Yeah.
That's what the RICO charges were to Italian. That's what these people do.
They fucking
don't do that. The fucking slimy little fucking grease balls.
Look, here's the thing.
Never had good politics, really.
I think the best way to operate in this small is beautiful world that we are, you know, advocating for.
Yes.
Is to bring the mafia back, because it's like modern feudalism.
Y'all would let me be a consigliere?
For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I would have to be a consigliere too.
If I married an
Italian. I would amend the rule for the first generation.
Because we'll
get you an Italian wife.
Yeah, I'm marrying. Right? I'm marrying. Right, exactly. You know, that's an alliance right there.
You have to either be married in or like at least 75%.
I'll supply, maybe, you know.
Depending on the membership.
The cartel 15. Link too, you know.
Sure, yeah, exactly.
With my Hispanic side.
Sure. Yeah. But we don't do drugs. This is the thing. We're only in the
gambling. Oh, yeah, that rackets. Stuff is... That narcotics is bad.
That narcotics is bad business. I don't want it near schools. I don't want it near children.
What's going to happen to all the politicians in my pocket when I start doing
it? When I start doing it, exactly.
Yeah.
They regard gambling and prostitution as harmless vices.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that was another...
another fucking episode of...
Almost academic. What number is it? Something like 15, 14, 14, 14. I don't know. We're going to try to start doing them again.
I guess.
Yeah.
This was like, we're getting our back on our feet. Okay, so this one's going to be a little lazy. It's a little fucking more academic than almost. But
yeah, yeah. But we gave you guys really what you wanted. If you're willing to stick around, good faith. You got tears. Talk about the Jews, the Italians, the Irish.
I honestly don't know if I was coherent for 20 minutes of that.
No, I was. Well, okay. It made sense to me.
Okay.
I don't know if our friends will know what you're talking about.
No, I was just thinking of like, yeah, because I was like, I can't breathe.
Oh, you're talking just like physically coherent.
Yeah, like I was like,
that's good.
It's okay. It's fine.
We don't know how these new mics will catch it. They might get to hear what
I can't
quitting
breathe.
Nicotine I'm sounds breathing. Like. Exactly. All the phlegm coming up, etc.
No, actually, though, it's
a bit, yeah.
I actually, my lungs feel worse after not smoking than they do when they were smoking.
Yeah. But this man is taking the step. Yeah, we'll be back soon. Peace. That was good.
I can't breathe.